A very, very good morning to you. Ruth Ambogo and I were just having a small chat over here. Anyway, it's about time we delve into youth and politics. And my name is Hilda Wadidi. And today, for the very first time, in the spirit of the conversation we had last week on what it takes to be a leader, today we are going to discuss the complexities of power. You know, what is the impact of political scandals on the perpetrators and the electorate in general? With me in studio, I have the very able Benson Musungu, who is the National Youth Coordinator for ODM. Yeah. And then I also have one Ruth Ambogo, who is a political analyst and top 100 most influential Kenyans. So please, if you do have any questions, as you know, Ruth has been trending. I'm sure you know her very well. She's a politician as well. So we'd like to understand the background of some of these stories. But however, we are taking a different approach today. We just like to talk generally on scandals. So please, slide into our DM at Y254 channel. The hashtag is Y in the morning. Hashtag youth and politics if you'd like to be more specific. On Instagram, you can find us at Y254_channel. And on Facebook, you can find us at Y254. So please do not go anywhere. It's about time I allow them to say good morning to the Y254 family for the very first time.
Hello, good morning.
Good morning.
Yeah, my name, as you told, is Benson Musungu. I'm the National Youth Coordinator.
And
I'm happy to be here.
All right. And I'm Ruth Ambogo, political analyst, as well as the founder of Young Kenyan Women Leaders, which is basically an organization that's seeking to nurture and empower more leaders, get more women out there in the leadership space. Yes.
I get more women out there in the leadership space. I like that. God, please, the studio. Anyway, so in case you don't know what a political scandal is, well, it is an intense public communication of an action or event, either real or imagined, regarded as morally or legally wrong and causing general public outrage. So yes, we have a lot of politicians joining in the new movement, and we'd like to understand, why should the public care about a politician's private life?
Yeah, first of all, politicians politicians are owned by the public because they are public servants. So if you get into office by people, by people's votes, that means you're a people's property. So you must be all the time accountable to the people, including your personal life. Because everybody is watching you everywhere. Even the walls have ears. Whatever you say.
Even the walls have ears. I like that.
whatever you say, anywhere, everywhere, will be looked at by the people that you're doing. So so the politicians, because they were brought into office by people's votes, their lifestyle and everything must be in the public domain and must be scrutinized at all times. Yes.
Must be scrutinized.
At all times.
So you actually think that it's actually a thing? Like
it's accountability. It's accountability, and accountability starts by those nitty gritties. Your life. How do you walk? How do you eat? What is your lifestyle? That's why you remember those days. One time Michuki was seated and they saw his socks, and it was an opera everywhere. Ah, why is Michuki's socks? Why does it have a hole?
We need to stop being petty.
Because you must be accountable. Whatever, everything. Even today, they look at my beard and they'll say, ah, leo alikuja na beard, squeeze yako na beard zmi. Sana, you know, what is he doing? Yeah, like that. I've been told, yeah, we're gonna be at Mingi Sana, watakuwa na wewe ni Al-Shabaab. I'm like, no, it's just a style, you know. So, you must be accountable. Your lifestyle, you are everything. You are a public property since you decided to get into public stuff. But if you want to live your personal life, then that is it. People, nobody will bother you. I mean, nobody will want to know what you ate yesterday, where you live, whom you're married to, whom you're moving out with, and whatever.
I think for me, the reason why the public is concerned about a politician's private life, and even why we should be concerned about a politician's private life, is that your private life essentially determines the your character, you know? What you do in private is who you are, you get? So at the end of the day, that kind of character that you have as a private person is the same character you will carry on into leadership. And you understand that leadership is, it is a solid, it's a sacred responsibility. Essentially what people are doing is that they are taking away from themselves the ability to rule themselves and putting upon you mm-hmm. that power to govern us, to we are trusting you to lead us. Otherwise we would have led ourselves. Mm-hmm. So what we are doing is we are saying we have selected you based on your character, based on the fact that we've noticed that this is who you are, this is what you stand for. Mm-hmm. So for me, I think why we should be interested and why people are interested is because your character shapes the kind of leader that you become. Mm-hmm. If in private life you're a drug dealer, mm-hmm. what will prevent you from continuing with your drug dealing business and actually ending up ruining the lives of young people in the process? Because what happens is, mm-hmm. upon being when you're bestowed with power, mm-hmm. you even become a bigger drug dealer. If you are a murderer, you will become a bigger murderer, because power in a way has a way of
corrupting
and it also provides avenues for people to get away with things so easily. Mm-hmm. So if you were corrupt as a leader in mm-hmm. private mm-hmm. before you became a leader, mm-hmm. what will prevent you from even becoming a more corrupt person when you become a leader? So mm-hmm. I think your private life essentially spills over to your leadership, mm-hmm. and it shows who you are. It defines the kind of value system that you will put in place. Mm-hmm. And I've just mentioned the negatives. Let's talk about the positives. You know, yeah. If in private life you're a family person, you're a family guy, then in public you will be able to uphold values that are, you know, family related values. If in private you care about the health, you care about healthcare.
Yeah.
At the end of the day, what will end up happening is that we will see the same being portrayed in your leadership. Mm-hmm. So you cannot separate the leader, the public leader, from their private lives. Mm-hmm. So yeah. Your private life basically essentially determines who you become as a leader. Mm-hmm. So that is why we should be concerned. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I like that. I actually like that. Yeah, whoever you are on the inside is actually how you're also going to govern us.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's go to the issue of scandals now. Now that we know it matters.
Yes.
Now that your private life matters and the scandals are here with us. So according to literature on political scandals, according to a study that was conducted, the media actually does have a big role to play when it comes to the scandalization of certain events. So I'd like to understand. Let me even start with you, Ruth, because you're the one who has experience. She's not scandalous. No.
Musungu, please watch your mouth.
Okay. No, I'm not saying she's scandalous, but I'm saying that
she was trending last week.
Yes, yeah. Number one. Yeah. At number one.
Yes.
So I want to understand from you, do you believe that the Kenyan media does highlight stories the correct way, or do they sensationalize things?
Well, it's a two-way answer, mm-hmm. and this is, I think, based on my being trend. I mean, me trending last week.
Mm-hmm.
I think I got two sides of the coin to that question,
mm-hmm.
and this is from experience.
Mm-hmm.
That number one, there will be media that would be genuinely interested. There will be certain media houses and media platforms that would be genuinely interested in finding out what was your original agenda.
Yes.
Remember, for me, I was trending because I was exposing a con man. Yeah.
Yes, yes.
And there were certain media houses that were like, we really need to pick the story as it is. We mm-hmm. need to pick the agenda, this person's agenda as they exposed it, you know.
Mm-hmm,
and
mm-hmm.
my agenda was exposing a con man. So you'd find certain media houses that would actually report it as it was.
Mm-hmm.
And then you would find others that would sensationalize things. You know,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
you would find other media houses now turning the story around, because the thing about media is a good story will always sell.
Yeah.
Whether it is told correctly or told incorrectly, mm-hmm. a good story will always sell for the media houses.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a two-way thing. You mm-hmm. find in scandals, you will mm-hmm. find media houses choosing to focus on the perpetrator's life, which has got nothing to do with the scandal.
Yes.
So at the end of the day, driving mm-hmm. the whole conversation away from the scandal itself.
Mm-hmm.
And you'll find media houses that are like, okay, fine. So money has been stolen from NYS.
Yes.
You know, mm-hmm. 761 million shillings has been stolen from NYS.
Yeah.
So why can't we focus on when was this money stolen?
Yeah.
How was it stolen? Can we get the evidence so that we assist the lawmakers legal bodies,
mm-hmm.
investigative bodies, to be able to come up with evidence, mm-hmm. so that at the end of the day, these persons are persecuted.
Mm-hmm.
Are prosecuted.
Brought to books,
but then
rather.
You will find mm-hmm. other media houses that mm-hmm. will choose to focus on the inconsistencies. For instance,
mm-hmm.
let's talk about Ngirita.
Mm-hmm.
You remember the story of how now she was part of the she was one of the people who were accused as being as having participated in NYS scandal season 2.
Yes.
Now instead of the media focusing
I like
on
the way it has seasons nowadays,
it is. it's crazy. In fact, it's as if you're expecting a season three, yeah. You know, very sad, yeah? Mm-hmm. So you'd find some certain media houses saying, okay, fine, we are focusing on this scandal. We mm-hmm. want to understand how did this young lady mm-hmm. manage to get all these millions yeah. without supplying anything at all.
Yeah.
But then you'd find other media houses focusing on the kind of wig she has worn on in court, the kind of shoes she's wearing, you know?
That is
and
very
so
true.
Sensationalizing the whole thing
yeah.
and diverting attention mm. and focus from what the real issue is. Okay. Yeah.
Hey, okay, clearly I can see, Ruth, you're passionate about that because you've taken the tough side of this.
Yes.
Huh? Yeah. So, do you believe our media does its due diligence when it comes to reporting scandals?
In the past, the media has done well.
Mm-hmm.
The media has done well, if you ask me, because most of these corruption cases, mm-hmm. most of these scandals
mm-hmm.
have been splashed by the media.
Yeah.
And to detail,
mm-hmm.
you know,
mm-hmm.
you remember these investigative journalists on different media houses. I can't mention now because it's competition.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, and they could follow the matter. They could follow the matter so well,
mm-hmm.
deeply. But then now, after they do all that,
mm-hmm.
where do we go from there?
Mm-hmm.
Because now media houses, their work is just to expose.
Mm-hmm.
After exposing, now it's mm-hmm. now the other. The other government arms yeah. to take yeah. over,
mm-hmm.
like, you know, the judiciary.
Yeah.
It's work now, together with the police, to investigate now deeply. Because mm-hmm. what the media does, it mm-hmm. will just show their story
mm-hmm.
as per what they have heard, you know.
Yeah.
But now we have to get deeper.
Mm-hmm.
Through now the laid down structures, investigative authorities, and up to the, so as the matter can be taken now to mm-hmm. to the judiciary, to courts, and mm-hmm. the cases be heard and blah blah blah.
Mm-hmm.
So to me,
mm-hmm.
the work of the media mm-hmm. really, it's easy, it's good mm-hmm. because they love it. They mm-hmm. whether they
sensationalize
it or not, uh-huh. the fact is what you want to see.
Mm-hmm.
Is it being talked about?
Mm-hmm.
That is what we want to know.
Mm-hmm.
And after being talked about, after the expose,
mm-hmm.
what next?
Mm-hmm.
Are the other arms now taking it over from the media?
Mm-hmm.
Because that's their work. Mm-hmm. The media cannot investigate and after investigating, prosecute.
Yeah.
You get it?
Yeah.
Yes. So their work is to let the matter out.
Mm-hmm.
Let people talk about it.
Mm-hmm.
Let the politicians speak it, you
mm-hmm.
know,
mm-hmm.
and let it happen. But now after that, let the other arms take over
mm-hmm.
and make sure that everybody is brought to book.
I like that. However, Ruth, there's something you've talked about that has caught my attention,
yeah.
which is also part of the frameworks when it comes to dealing with a scandal in the event
yeah.
that it happens. Because most young people are very discouraged to join politics because they are afraid
mm-hmm.
to be exposed.
Yeah.
They are
yeah.
afraid of these things. And there's something you mentioned about the spillover. It's called the spillover effect.
Yeah.
Like what happened in the case of the NYS season one and season two.
Mm.
Apparently, when a scandal happens to this particular company and then it repeats itself another time, the perception of the public becomes more favorable towards the original offenders.
Mm-hmm.
Like now people tend to take it lightly, or the attention now diverts from them to the others.
Mm-hmm.
So I like the fact that, for example, you've experienced it firsthand. You
yeah,
were doing an
yeah.
expose for a con man.
Mm-hmm.
However, when you started trending, it became a whole different
story. To stand around. Yes, yes.
From the original
yeah,
offender.
Yeah.
So I'd like to understand from you guys, what do you guys think about this?
You know, I think, and I have spoken about this yesterday and even on Friday, and it's an emerging topic, yeah,
mm-hmm.
and this has got to do with women,
mm-hmm.
more specifically women.
Oh,
when women come up
mm-hmm.
and expose an injustice that has been done to them, expose that they have suffered sexual harassment,
mm-hmm.
they have gone through gender-based violence,
mm-hmm.
what ends up happening is that they suffer what we call victim blaming and victim shaming.
Mm-hmm.
So the story turns around. So you're here exposing a con man,
mm-hmm.
you're here exposing a gentleman who gave you herpes,
mm-hmm.
you're here exposing a man who raped you,
mm-hmm.
or a spouse who mistreated you, who beat you up,
yeah.
and then the story turns around and the story becomes, oh, you were a jilted lover,
mm.
oh, you are also a con man as well. The story becomes, especially for rape cases, yeah. they tell you, oh, why were you at that club at that particular yes. time? What were you doing out? Yeah, what were you doing out? Why did you dress in a particular way?
Yeah.
Why didn't you call for help? You know, why didn't you leave that marriage? Mm-hmm. You know, and then the story now turns from us focusing on the perpetrator to the person who is the victim, you know? Mm-hmm. And essentially what this does is that it discourages people from coming out. Because like now in my case, when I exposed this guy, the one thing I noticed was the women kept quiet. My female friends, my people, women on Twitter, guys just kept quiet, you know? Because the thing is, you would be seen, would you be seen supporting me? You would also be a victim,
you
know?
Yeah, you'd also
they would
be
come
trolled.
For you. They would be like, "Do you? How do you even know her?
Yeah.
I guess you are also part of the scheme to con people, you know? So, but then the other thing I also noticed was that courage to come out also inspired other young people to come out. And on that particular day, to be honest, I saw almost 10 other con men and con women being exposed on social media,
that's
you
true,
know?
That's true,
so the spillover effect can work in two ways.
Mm-hmm.
In one of the ways being that you as the victim, doing the expose, you as the victim, you as the victim who has suffered certain injustice, being victim blamed and victim shamed, or the other side of things being that now you'd find more people coming out courageously and saying, okay, this also happened to me. This person also conned me, you know. So it's a two-way street, you know.
Okay, Musungu, what do you think? Especially now, I like the fact that when it comes to Ruth, she can be able to tell her own story. But when it comes to the National Youth Service, do you think that we went easy on the original NYS1 suspects compared to how we are reacting for this second time round?
You know, we should appreciate where we've come from. The way I just said that the media has its work and it did its work then.
Together with
the opposition, you remember then.
Mm-hmm.
And when all is said and done, the media can never go to the next level now. You know, the next level now is now the prosecution. What they can only do is to follow up in court what now the prosecutors are doing, what the courts are doing. You know, we cannot really now it gets back now to our country as Kenya. How are we treating corruption cases? That is the question that will come out now. Because we had NYS1. It has been in court all through. I heard they released a few. No, that was NYS season 2. That released around 12 suspects.
Yeah, for lack
just
of evidence.
That for lack of evidence.
Yeah.
You know. So it's all about now we as a country. How strong are we taking the fight against corruption?
Okay.
How is the prosecution? How are the courts treating this? That's why the other day you saw the conference, the corruption conference at Bomas, and questions were being asked, blows thrown, and you see at that time that's when I realized now people have little. Some trust with the prosecutors, with the prosecution, the DPP, at least. People have some trust with the investigative arm, that is the criminal investigative, the new CID boss, you know. But now the problem was now, what about the judiciary? Are they doing enough?
Oh yeah.
And that is why there were issues around there. And I'm happy that after that conference, at least last week, the Chief Justice met all his judges, and the subject was how do we
speed up
corruption cases.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm thinking we are headed somewhere. We are moving in the right direction, especially after the handshake.
I like that.
But you see, I have a particular concern here. We can't really say that we have really done our best when it comes to the media in terms of investigating these corruption cases. Because the thing is, the media plays, in as much as they're not supposed to prosecute, there is a level to which when media probes an issue, then the issue is taken seriously.
Pressure.
You have seen cases whereby basic general social issues, social issues where you hear, a certain preacher has been raping his congregants or congregation. Certain social issues that have come up on media, where the media has seriously investigated, deeply investigated, and actually aided the policemen in doing what? In arresting individuals,
that
you know?
Is true.
I honestly feel like our media is lazy. And I feel like our media is also compromised. If our media can investigate social issues, media houses can investigate social issues and actually get the police involved. Like, remember there was this scandal, there was this case of a syndicate of women who used to sell babies. I think somewhere in Eastlands or where.
Pumwani.
Yeah, forget about even Pumwani. There was a Pumwani case as well as a certain case somewhere in Eastlands.
Yes.
One of those estates in Eastlands where women were running a syndicate of selling babies and you know, stealing babies from people or getting into contracts with people to sell babies. The media, there was a media house that investigated it thoroughly. And what ended up happening is that as a result of their investigation, police actually took action. The women were arrested. Even Mugo, remember this Mugo guy?
Mugo Wairimu.
The one, yeah, Mugo Wairimu. The one who the first time he escaped, the second time media also highlighted him and he was actually arrested.
Yes.
So I feel like when it comes to corruption cases, our media houses are number one, lazy, and number two, compromised. Compromised in what sense? You see, most of these political scandals are scandals involving politicians as well as parastatals and very huge parastatals, NHIF, you know, we're talking about NYS.
But we political digress. We wanted to talk about individuals.
Yeah.
You know, when it comes to individuals, because here in Kenya, the types of scandals that we have seen, especially according to the list, we have abuse of power.
Yes.
We have tax. We have sex and violence. We have corruption, which we have dwelt on for a minute. But Ruth, this is not a fight with the media.
No. Listen, I have. Let me tell you. This point has to actually come out, and I'm not going to relent on expressing it out.
Okay.
What I mean by media houses being compromised is. You really want to tell me that politicians don't pay media houses to shut down stories? They do. There have been cases of politicians bribing media houses, paying them off to actually shut down scandals that are coming up. This is not news. This is not breaking news or anything. It is something that happens. And that is why I'm saying that kind of laxity and that kind of compromise is what leads to us quickly forgetting scandals. Let me tell you something about the United States of America. There was the first and foremost thing about the United States of America is that most of its media is independent. You'd find a lot of independent media houses.
Yes, they are
media
not very
houses that don't
compromised.
Rely on
yes.
government
yeah.
for advertising because Kenyan media relies a lot and heavily on government funding to run because what you'd find is ministries are advertising their products and paying heavily for it. You know, parastatals are advertising their products and also paying for it.
Yeah.
So when a scandal comes up, for instance, a scandal comes up that involves a parastatal that has been advertising on Y254, do you think that Y254 would actually say, you know what, we need to play our role as media and forget about the fact that we have been earning a cool 100 million shillings from this particular parastatal. Trust me, money will always come first for a media house. If a media house has been receiving millions in terms of advertising costs from a particular parastatal and a scandal comes up, I kid you not, the media house will sit down and ask, we know we have economic interests. You will see certain media, and that's why you'll find when a scandal comes out, certain media houses will not even mention a word of that scandal, and other media houses will do
but
what?
But
Ruth, you look like you have a bone to pick with the media.
I am just saying that our media houses need to style up.
It could be again.
We need to style up.
We go again and ask who owns the media, you know? Because the media. It's only KBC that is owned by the public.
Because what I'm getting from you when it comes to
these other media houses are owned by the same people,
politicians that you expect to be exposed.
Oh, so here in Kenya, you know? When it comes to dealing with a scandal, the information I've gotten from you two is that just buy your way out of it. Thank you.
That is what happens.
Yes,
and that is what
but
needs
we need
to
the
stop.
Ideal situation.
Yes.
Where we. Where a scandal is exposed, no matter who you are in the society, even if that's your media house, it will say as it is that Benson has stolen chicken. You know? So Benson stole chicken in the house of whatever, and he should be prosecuted. You know? That is it. Whether Benson owns whichever station, that station will still come out strongly.
Report without fear.
Without fear.